two and three wheelers, I believe, are the game changers in the EV revolution in India. And the next panel that I'm hosting is about two-wheeler, three-wheeler adoption, the challenges and the opportunities. In this panel, I would like to invite Mr. Sohinder Gill, who is the CEO of Hero Electric. He's also the Director General of SMEV. Along with him, we have Dr. Dave Mukherjee, Managing Director, Omega Steki, and Mr. Jitendra Sharma, MD and Founder, Okinawa Autotech. We also have Mr. Nilay Chandra, who is the Director of Charging Infrastructure for Ather Energy, one of the fastest growing two-wheeler startups in India. Now they have also migrated to North India, and the North Indians are actually looking forward to driving this scooter. So I welcome you all to this panel. Now let me start with a very soft topic. During the COVID lockdown, we all saw nature recovering itself. There were a lot of articles about Yamuna becoming cleaner and a lot of greenery all around. So let me start with Sohinder Gill sir. Sir, could you tell me how was the effect of lockdown on the EV industry? Was it positive post-lockdown? Was it a positive thing? Did people show more interest in electric vehicles because people are not really traveling too much nowadays?
Thanks, Siddharth. Yeah, the demand did not really go down much. The inquiry levels converted from walk-ins to phones. The limitation was network was down, so deliveries were not happening. So many of our members who were able to find innovative ways of delivering were also able to partially recover the sales. So it was a lot of inquiries, but half of them fell through because of distribution channel was not backing up. But then last year, the same thing happened. And after the COVID fear was over and lockdowns were over, the pent up demand translated into almost doubling the numbers in the next few months. In fact, as an industry, the last 3 months of the financial year, the run rate of the industry was twice of previous year. So that gave us optimism that had COVID not been here this year, the industry would have clocked twice or more than twice of the previous year. But unfortunately, again, there is a 2 months, 3 months of blackout. So perhaps the industry may be touching 1.5 to 2 times current year also.
Mr. Jitendra Sharma, I would like to take this question to you. How has Okinawa Autotech seen the lockdown and the post-lockdown period?
So first of all, if you talk about the lockdown, I think it was a challenge for everyone, because many states are locked down, some are partial lockdown. Because of that, maybe some supply chain is also affected for that, because the OEMs is not getting the parts on time, and that's why the same in time they cannot deliver the vehicles to their network. And because of these things, I think of course there is a lots of these inquiries are coming to the dealership, even online bookings are coming, but the challenge for delivery of the vehicles to the end user was there. But fortunately, some states have some partial lockdown with some restricted things, like you can open the network for some hours or some alternatives like this. So network, our dealers are delivering the vehicles to the end user for that. But of course, the number of vehicles which has to sell as per our estimation and as per the industry estimation, it was not coping to that one. But of course, once the lockdown is over, of course, there is a lots of opportunities going to happen for the, especially for EV two-wheelers, because there's an increase in the petrol prices is there already. Everybody understand the petrol price is touching around 100 rupees. And because of this, by the same time, the cost of the running of the electric vehicle is almost 1/10 of the petrol vehicles. So it will give the boost to the overall industry of EV. And of course, people also understand now the product which is available in the market, they are like a performance vehicle which can match the performance equal to IC engine in some how. So now they are getting the more and more confidence on the product itself. And of course, they are also understand the end of the day, the running cost is less. They are saving their money, because when a IC engine person goes to the petrol pump and they are putting petrol every day and cutting their pocket. And once we are at the same time with the EV owner, they understand they no need to pay anything. They have to charge the two-wheeler at their home, at their office, just like charging their mobile phone. So it makes the convenience to the consumer, and this will bring the boost to the overall industry once the lockdown will 100% over. And we see it's going to be 2 times, 3 times in a this financial year when the lockdown is over.
Absolutely, sir. And I believe people looking at the nature, going green and not much of interstate travel now, I believe this is going to be a big push for EVs. Now I'll move to Mr. Dr. Mukherjee. Dr. Mukherjee, could you tell us how has your experience been pre and post lockdown?
Yeah, thanks, Dad. And obviously, lockdown did put brakes on the entire industry. And the traditional IC engine industry has seen a sort of a fall from that cliff. And we are seeing the numbers now coming out. As far as the three-wheeler electric industry is concerned, I think that is one industry which has seen an upsurge. And I mean, Corona has been the reason, you know, the same reason which has brakes on economy is actually the reason which has led to growth of this industry. It is a bit of paradox, but it is what it is. The reason is that the one sector which we have seen, growing is the e-commerce. And electric three-wheelers have been the big part of the last mile delivery here. So we have seen quite a big demand. In fact, our demand is almost doubling since pre-corona time. And also we are seeing one more aspect of it, that technology is playing a big role here. As the technology is maturing and the economic impact of this maturing technology is seen now, in the sense that now we have a three-wheeler, we designed and we came up with a three-wheeler which is the first one with a refrigerated box, and it is ideally suited for pharma industry. For example, vaccine, vaccine transportation is a huge project where the central government, state governments and various other agencies are involved. So this is something where we came out with a product and we are now doing it with several pharma companies and governments. Also, it is ideally suited for delivery of food. We also have special food boxes using cooling and refrigeration, where food can be delivered in a very hygienic and clean way, where post-corona we see more and more sort of awareness and sensitivity towards this sector. So what I mean is that, one is the corona-led growth during the lockdown period, driven by e-commerce. Also, the technology-led growth during this period. This has been a combination and, volume growth for us. So let's see how it goes. And we are very bullish. We are very upbeat on this. And,
Great to hear that, sir. Now, coming to Nilay, Aether Energy, on the other hand, has actually, between 2020 and 2021, come to North India as well. So how has your experience been with the COVID-induced pre-lockdown and post-lockdown?
Honestly, it's been, COVID has obviously been something that's sad for all of us, that it's happened to consumers. But in the breaks of it, I think we've also seen the glimmer of hope of how the future would be. We almost interact with the aspiring India, the part of India which is, a little established, they're at their jobs, etc. And I think that segment through this COVID period is really looking forward to how their future would be. Right? They're pretty more conscious, and now I think our worries are more on during COVID was to how to reduce the amount of footfall that's there at the stores, because I think the demand has shot up very, very high, right? Because consumers have started to realize that now if they're going to buy a new vehicle which is for the future, it has to be electric, right? And like we mentioned some time back, I think the economics have sort of started working together. The awareness levels have gone up, like some bit of what we have done, some bit of what the industry has done, some bit of what the government has done. And even the publication world, right? The amount of news that I think all publications today put out about electric vehicles actually go in a long way on building the awareness, trust of the consumer towards electric vehicles. So I think it's been a ride upwards, and as we again get into a more stable condition, we are really looking forward to grow not just 2x, 3x. I think we want to grow 20-30% every month. That's how we want to grow.
That's great to hear. All of you have been really positive about the pre and the post COVID lockdown. Now let's coming to the core topic. Cost. Now EVs are expensive compared to the traditional ICE engine vehicles. And specifically for two-wheelers and three-wheelers, this is a very, very price-sensitive market. So I would like to start with Gil Saab. Could you tell us what goes into the pricing? I mean, everybody knows lithium-ion battery is expensive, but what else could be there for that goes into the pricing and makes electric vehicles expensive? How can all of us reduce the price and make it more viable for the customer?
Two things. One is scale, and second is the batteries. Batteries, understandably, because they're the fuel. Scale, because we are all at suboptimal levels of operating, even at a, for example, I'm doing, as far as my sister company makes, they make in one day, I make in a year. So that's the type of a scale that we are in. So obviously it's far cry to say that costs will come down in the next 1 or 2 years till we really are able to reach that level of scale. And batteries will follow a natural curve, like Shulja was saying. In fact, this year the battery lithium prices are up. But on a long term, yes, certainly so. So there's a gap between the future, like Abhinav was saying, can future become present? That's everybody's trying to do. We all know that we'll have 5 million vehicles or whatever, 10% vehicle in 10 years. What we will have in the next 2 years will make way for that. Can we have 1 million in the next 2 years or 3 years? Is the moot question here. So for that, the costs have to be artificially brought down. Because affordability, like everybody is saying, is equally important as TCO. And TCO sets in after the lifetime of a vehicle. And the confidence doesn't really come till there are a large number of them. So the TCO is not really a buying parameter as of now till scale sets in. Running cost, yes, surely. But still there is a confusion in the mind of customer on why should I buy it at 1.2, 1.4, 1.5 times of a petrol bike, where I am spending 40,000 extra, I will take 2 years to recover that in terms of petrol saving. So that's where we all have to work and government has to pitch in. That is where we keep telling from the association to the government that there are three types of vehicles today. Low speed, city speed, high speed. What we should try to do collectively is create great quality vehicles and leave it to the customers who wants to buy what. Today, unfortunately, these criteria of range, speeds are coming synonym to the performance of the vehicle. So if we remove that for the time being and talk of quality certifications, for one, we should get out of lead batteries, for example, as a country. No more lead batteries. Second is, the motor efficiency should be governing factor. Not less than 85% efficiency motor should be used. Even plastics. So many vehicles have banana skin plastics. So there are so many standards that can be set in and then leave it to manufacturers to adhere to those standards, yet make the vehicle suiting any type of customer they want to cater to, whether he's doing 40 kilometers a day, 25 kilometers speed, or 180 kilometers a day, 70 kilometers speed. And all of them, if they are promoted well together in some way or form, we will get the 2 million. So that's the difference between what policy is trying to do in terms of increasing the numbers to the threshold where scale will offset the costs. That is not crossing in the next 2 or 3 years. That is crossing as of now in the 5 or 7 years period. Either we wait patiently or we do something on that side. Industry itself has to pitch in. They can't be creating vehicles which are not even called automobiles on the automotive products in the road. We all have to come up to a standard of good quality with our own conscience and then promote those vehicles which really last for a long time, not just a toys or 3 or 4 years type of an operation. Because resale value is another thing that is so much in the minds of customer. Until that gets established, the quantity will not come out. So these are the 2 or 3 things, besides obviously everybody is talking of awareness and so many other things, that costs will come down when scale comes. Cost will come down when battery prices go down. In the meanwhile, costs have to be brought down by creating vehicles catering to everybody in the country as a mobility solution. Not only equal performing, not only similar to Activas and this, and that is a customer choice. And together, we have to create 2 million, not one segment or two segments. Thank you.
Right, sir. Jitendraji, tell us, how do you think we can reduce the price of the two-wheelers in electric and make it more viable. There are some permutation combinations also going on where you can buy the vehicle, but not actually buy the battery along with the vehicle. So what do you think about all these, and how can we all together can reduce the price of the two-wheeler to make it more viable?
If you talk about the electric two-wheeler prices, the first question comes in the owner's mind is that whether it's say costly, ownership of the vehicle is more expensive than ICE engine or not. The first thing comes is if after BS6, the price of ICE engines already has increased. So now the gap between the ICE engine after BS6 and the EV two-wheeler is not so much. Of course, there is a gap, but not so much. So by the same time, of course, the running cost is, of course, is another parameter where the customer has to decide whether they will go for it or not. But by the same time, how to reduce the cost of the overall product? That only possible, I think, in my opinion or the Okinawa what we are doing, I think localization is one of the biggest parameter which can make enable the vehicle more cheaper than as compared to when you import the product. The reason behind that is not only the cost, there is other parameter like after sales service. Second thing is the quality of the product, because in the people's mind, when you talk about that product is made in India, you are making all your supply chain from India, you have a direct control of the quality of the product at your supplier end. If some problem happens, you can take immediate action for that, so that your customer will maybe more satisfied. Because when we talk about the numbers, it's only possible when there is a demand and supply. When the demand is more, you have lots of supplies from your supplier, then cost of the product goes down. Because when it's made viable for the ancillary suppliers, because they, at the end of the day, they are doing the business. They also want whatever their investment they have done for this EV component manufacturing, there is a ROI for that also. And that is only possible when there is demand and supply there. Of course, we can meet those requirements. Of course, one is parameters, of course, 30-40% the cost of the battery. And as globally, the rate of the lithium-ion battery, of course, is going down this year because of the COVID and other things happening because of the pandemic. The overall raw material cost has increased globally as well as India also. But I think it's not, you can say, going to be a very long journey for cost of this battery going like this only. I think this curve will goes down, probably maybe in next 6 months or next 1 year. So finally, the cost of the vehicle is going down in case of the battery, because as of today, India, everyone is importing the battery and we are paying the cost of this lithium-ion cells, putting the import duties and other things also. And by the same time, now some companies are also come forward. Government is also taking the initiative to start this battery cells manufacturing in India. Probably, I think one plant is coming south of India also. Probably in next 2 years it will be start operating also. So of course the cost is going to down once it is manufacturing in India. But by the same time, of course, after 40%, this is 60% product is also there. Component is there where the cost lies. With that, how to reduce it? It's also a supply chain is in India, where all the OEMs, if we take the part from those suppliers, of course their viability is there, and the cost of the product ownership is going to down. So we have to see in both the sides how we can take it as a stakeholder, because it's a total responsibility of all the stakeholders, who are whether it's OEM, it's a policymaker, government, or the customers. Because end of the day, because India is a cost-sensitive market. So people want the good product at the reasonable cost. That is the main requirement of a consumer. And that is only possible if you say it's a product which is component supplied by the Indian suppliers. And as government has announced lots of PLI scheme for that also, where these people are getting incentives by the suppliers. So of course the cost of the product, the component is going to down. And in future, in next another 1 year or 2 years, it's going to be more and more down, because the FAME II scheme also talk about that the product should be 100% made in India by the end of this financial year, and all the OEMs are working for that. So it's a matter of time only. Of course, this cost is going to down, and we have to give a quality product to our customer. Then only there is an increase in demand in the market. And I think all the OEMs, all the as a stakeholder, we have to take that responsibility and give the right good product at the right cost. So it will make sense for everyone, and of course this cost will reduce in a span of maybe another 6 months or 1 year.
Absolutely, sir. Now, coming to Dr. Mukherjee, Dr. Mukherjee, you are into three-wheeler space. Now, how price sensitive is this, and what are your, how are you going to reduce the price to make it more viable for a B2B buyer?
Yeah, see, that's, you know, what Gilsar has mentioned, you know, I agree to that. You know, the scale is essential in a very capital intensive industry like automotive, and the returns come over a long period of time. There is a long gestation period. But I also believe, and I am of that school of thought, that technology will bring the cost down. And I think my friend Niloy here can probably second to that. We have a lot of respect for the technology in their scooter and the way they produce and their design, etc. I think technology is going to be the answer, and not just, you know, buying cheap products, etc., importing them and then hashing it up here into some contraption which runs on two wheels or three wheels. You know, that is not going to be the, that is not the right answer or right way. What I believe is that, you know, a disruptive technology like the electric is going to is going to bring in this change of, or solving this whole cost versus value equation, particularly more so relevant in India. You know, I'll just, let's go back, you know, 20 years ago, you know, we had telecom sector coming up, mobile telephony, you know. The tele density in 2000 was less than 7, means less than 7 people in 100 has phone, you know, less than 7. Today it is 85%. You know, in 2000, the central government led by Bajpayee Saab came up with the first telecom policy, and that is where the inflection or the tipping happened, and then the volumes grew exponentially. That is where the scale come. And also during that period, you know, what happens is in the typical S curve, when you have that tipping point, and I believe that this tipping point for EVs is coming now, especially in two-wheelers and three-wheelers, and with the serious players getting into it. So I think the whole consolidation will happen, number one. Secondly, the technology will disrupt it in a manner that the cost will come down, like we have seen in telephony, we have seen in computers and many other sectors. It typically follows that curve. So take the case of on the supply side as well as demand side for three-wheelers. The three-wheeler is a commercial vehicle, you know, nobody buys three-wheeler for personal use. So obviously, the economic benefit is the prime motive for the user, my customer. So on the supply side, we have the battery and the powertrain, which is roughly, you know, 60% of the vehicle cost. Now, the battery has to be also robust in quality, because there are safety issues, there are thermal management issues, there is a charge density issue, there is a life issue. So these four or five issues, I believe that technology will overcome in next 2 to 3 years. I do see single charge running, you know, 300 to 400 kilometers. I mean, that kind of charge density, it will at least double. And we, as a company, we are also working on it. We have worked with Log9, which has the graphene battery. We are working with the C4V, which is a cutting edge technology of solid state. So these are the technologies which not only bring in a huge change in the performance of the battery, but also lowers the cost. See, that is what is disruption. You increase the value at a lower cost, right? So these are the two things on the supply side. On the demand side, you know, we see that there are a whole lot of stakeholders involved. There is a charging infrastructure involved, there is a grid company involved, there are the financing companies involved, there are IT solutions involved, and also the government. Now, government has come out with some fiscal policies as well as monetary. So those have to translate into the actual benefit for the end user. See, the NITI Aayog document itself shows that less than 1% of the FAME II has been utilized, you know, till now. So this is something which should worry us, you know, and there are reasons. They also highlight some of the reasons. So I think all the stakeholders on the supply side as well as the demand side have to work together to solve this whole equation of cost versus the quality and the whole, you know, the pricing issue for India. We have to give, we have to increase the value and also reduce the price up to an optimized level. We can't reduce the value to reduce the price. I think that is my view, and I think I mean, we are working on this.
Great, sir. Absolutely right. Now, coming to you, Nile, Ather, I believe, is in a peculiar position, because even though the product is expensive, 450X, but you guys have a cult following. So now tell us, what is your point of view in terms of reducing the cost and making it more viable to future customers?
I end up saying this in multiple forums. I don't think Indian consumer is necessarily cost sensitive. They're value sensitive, right? And I think that there is a difference over there. It's not always to say that the Indian consumer wants the lower and lower price product. In fact, like more and more, it's just changing the other way. Indian consumers want good products at good value and a good price, right? So that's the first context to get, right? Now, like Mr. Gill said, and I completely agree, I think scale is the biggest upside that can get in the cost part of it down. So breaking it into demand side and breaking it into the cost part. So I think scale and related to that technology, right? Are all our players investing in technology, or are we in a hurry to get some bit of volume today? Okay, I think it's a very important aspect of how we are growing this industry today, right? So I think technology has the ability. We've been fortunate to see our costs go half and half and half by consistently being focused on technology to bring things down, and it's possible. I think everybody in the panel is saying, let's say if we did not take a very stringent move, the battery prices will fall down. And in, let's say, a 5 years period, the cost will start making sense. So the task over here is, how do we make that 5 years into a 2 years? It's not a fundamental question of whether it can be cost effective. So then we are looking at a stimulus which accelerates the cost, the cost benefits, of which technology is a strong mode. But I would rely a lot more on the demand side of stuff. So I think Ms. Raja mentioned it. I think loans, for example, has one of the biggest powers of the area where the government can put a very strong push in the next 2 years to actually accelerate the number of vehicles on road. And I think that's how we should change the task. All our discussions are, what can we do in 2030, right? At best, a few of them I've attended is, what can we do in 2025? There is no meeting which says that how aggressive can we get in 2022, right? And I think that's the change of lens. If all of us started looking, saying, what is the highest number that the industry can reach in 2022? Because the shape of the curve has repeated itself category after category. We need to make the shape move steeply upward in the next year, right? Now, loan, I think, is one big area of it, right? There were some discussions upon, and I'm happy that everybody's discussing quality, right? FAME 1 allowed anybody in the market to, you know, grow the market. It did not put a very stringent quality measure. And I think we saw there that probably wasn't the most successful way that India could grow this country. We heard Ms. Silaja talking about how in the three-wheeler industry, not regulating quality enough is leading to some things about how that category is growing. Right? So one way to look at it is that, how fast can we grow this category in the short term? That will give scale and we can move from there. The other is, in the process of doing that, how is the category getting perceived by the audience, who today are 1% of the world, but of that universe, but will get to a 20, 30, 40, 50% growth. And there, I think having good products is very, very important. And I agree to Mr. Gill when he says that good products does not only necessarily need to be the most expensive product. But the fact is that when you enter a category, the consumers need to look at electric vehicles as an upgrade. Right? And I will hold on to that word. Either it's a government forced regulation which makes anybody and everybody own the product, or it is seen as an upgrade. Right? And I think if we can stay true to that, then we will find products in the market with the help of policy and with the help of what OEMs are looking at, which sort of sort for that, right? Now, if you go to a part of our entire scooter market where the range is low, then I think charging infrastructure becomes way more important. Right? Again, going back to Ms. Silaja's note, right? She said that a typical vehicle does 70, 80, and hence in an intra-city, the criticality of charging infrastructure is not very high. When you change that, And you focus on the different parts of the segments, which is also a way of growing the market, then I think the amount of investment that we need to do in charging infrastructure to make that successful should be higher than what we are otherwise doing, right? So we should look at which segment to go to get to the first million based on what it requires on investment across spaces. And I think having good products is like the faster lever to getting to it. Like, for example, committing resale. One of the problems that this industry can solve for is that, how do you insulate future? Is the policy of the government stable for the next 5 years? Is there a commitment towards it? Is resale of the consumer who is buying today guaranteed at some price? Because if the battery prices are going to fall down, will the resale value substantially go down? I think it is things on these sides which is required to be focused on, with a very strong focus of getting somewhere in the next, I would say, 1 year, right? because the consumers who are today going to be moving to an electric vehicle, the bulk of the two-wheeler category is still in the scooter side, sitting on the 110, 125. A lot of migration is happening from the motorcycles. So I think that's the consumer that we should look at and say, how do we fast get that first medium? Would be the way I would look.
Some great points there, Nilay. Now, we have 15 minutes more. So quickly, I need to address the biggest topic here. Easy credit. Now, all of you have spoken about, how to get easy credit going for the customers. So what do you think here are the bottlenecks? Why are firms not really into financing electric vehicles as of now? Gil Saab, I'd like to start with you.
Well, if I'm a financer, I won't do that because for me, if I have to put my $2 on the side where I'm getting a lot of turnover on a per man basis or a per rupee basis, that's surely petrol side, not electric. So I'll wait for others to do it, first of all. Secondly, I'll try to do it in a very small experiment and then see the result of that. For example, the resale value itself, such a dampener for any financer by itself. Till the time it gets established, like Nilay is saying, the financier would say, what happens if the consumer himself is not seeing the resale value? How will he be able to finance my EMIs? Besides that, is basically a natural curve of financing, where the risk-taking capacity has to come out of some big financiers. And now they are coming up. We have seen lately in the last 1 year, from Tata to so many others, they are jumping into it. But they are going through a natural curve of sort of a proof of concept. And I think, especially in the B2B, in 6 to 9 months, there would be enough finances available because there is a backing of two partners there, the consumer, the rider, as well as a backup over there and the company. And when some sort of covering up of any of the faulty loans, etc., it can be a big game in B2B and then open to B2C. Government surely can do a bit in this. Everybody is saying that. And government can easily direct through RBI. Public sector banks under some yojana, like for EDIC, there was a yojana, Kisan, like Bharat Kisan Yojana or something. So they can easily start a EV yojana where the interest rates need not go down. But public sector manager, bank managers have to be told to proactively finance. That's all. So any consumer who walks in, he looks at the guy, he says, I don't know anything about it. Just read the circular there and don't follow it up. So that push has to come from the government because all across the country, there are banks which are going into hinterlands, and that's where the vehicle can also go, provided finance backs up. Other models, which are innovative models, are also coming up, like a buyback, AMC ridden, lease rental basis, are also to do with the sort of a confidence of the battery life. Because if EMIs are spread over 5 years and battery packs up in between, there is always a ruckus between a consumer and the financier or the company that I won't pay because what was committed to me is not happening. So somewhere down the line, the OEMs also have to work. If they want to get the vehicle financed, then the life cycle of the vehicle has to be much better. The battery technology has to be protected properly. It can't be on a yearly basis or a monthly basis. It has to be on a clearly defined cycle time basis. There are so many cycles you have consumed, so you are run with the battery. And at the back end, the resale value. Many of these factors, including government support, can really turn the tide in 6 to 9 months towards the 2 million goal in the next 2 years.
Right, sir. Jitendraji, I would like to ask you, electric vehicles do have telemetry, do have a lot of technology inside them. So after, say, 2 years of usage, the user, the company, the insurer, the financier can actually know the real status of the vehicle. How bad is it? What kind of wear and tear it has gone through? Yet, the financing schemes or the financial support is not really out there as much as it should be, like in the case of ICE vehicles. So what do you think are the challenges here?
Yeah, if you see, talk about the vehicles for ICE engine, when we talk about the retail financing, as in today, the total overall market of this 20 million vehicles, I think 70% or 80% is only financed. Customer comes in the ICE engine showroom and they got financed, because the finance is very easily available for them. And when we talk about the EV vehicle, there is a lot of challenge because there is not push from the banks, because they always think the volume is not so much. One thing is that. Second thing, when you talk about the EV person goes for this vehicle for the finance, they ask what is your profile of the customers. And same way when IC engine, sometimes they overlook the profile of the customer also, and they take a chance, because sometimes there is a possibility as a banker, as a financier, they always take how much percentage of it will be defaulter. Maybe when the volume scale is too much in the IC engine, they take that, accept this challenge. But when talk about the EV, when they think, okay, I have to just finance only 1 lakh vehicles, and if there is a defaulter percentage too much, then how they will take care of their interest cost and other things also. Second thing, of course, as a second resale value of the product is also very important for that. And third thing is usage of the vehicles. In case of EV, this is very important. As on today, people are using, actually they are abusing the vehicle actually, because the awareness about the product, and this is a responsibility of OEMs and overall all the stakeholders, how they use it. The reason behind that, the usage of vehicle is not like that how the OEMs has directed the customer to do it as per their warranty norms and other things. So they are using in a very rough manner, and once the vehicles got you can say unoperational, they always think that the quality is not good, and they stop giving the your EMIs to the banks, and that makes the negativity about this product, and as well as the for the bankers to take a backseat whether they will finance it or not. So it's a all together, all the stakeholder has to come forward, understand how we can make this market bigger in way how to use the vehicle. Rate of interest should be same as the IC engine. The profile of the customer, what is their benchmarking for the customer, whether it's for IC two-wheeler or for the EV two-wheeler, it should be same for them. And second thing, as you your question about the technology, like where the financier can understand how this. Now, lots of technology has already evolved around this EV. Artificial intelligence, IoT is already inbuilt in this. Even in our product, Okinawa product, we already have this type of facilities already there in our top-notch models also. So where you can understand what is the wear out of the product, what is the now maintenance reminders is already there, how much is the battery life is there, the cycle of the batteries, how much is remaining, so that they can understand. And case of default also, you can immobilize the product also. So now there's a lots of technologies already there, like in you go to the Western countries. So like this is one of the major parameter for these finance companies, that there must be a IoT is there, so that in case of any default, they can stop the product and they can repossess that product. But by the same time, the resale value of the product they have to ensure. But we as a stakeholder, we should also understand this market is a new in India and overall globally also. To establish the second-hand cost of the vehicle, it will take some time. When we compare with the IC engine, it's already 100 years old company industry. So we know when we use any IC engine two-wheeler, three-wheeler, four-wheeler, it's already established product, India as well as globally also. They understand how much wear pattern is there. So for EV, it takes of course time and to establish the second-hand cost of this. And for this, to make it more rigorous to do it the retail financing, of course the PSU has to come forward, and the policy maker has to make a policy where if the EV vehicle, they want to make a electrification of this industry. We are talking about our vision of 2030, that this much of sale has to be happen. So I think they have to be very strict about this policy and to implement this policy by the PSUs and the other banks also, then it makes sense for everyone.
Absolutely right, sir. So now coming to Dr. Mukherjee. Dr. Mukherjee, you are dealing with three-wheelers. Now commercial vehicles also have a second life or a third life where they're sold again and again. So talking about resale and financing options, what are the challenges that you are facing in the three-wheeler set?
Yeah, you know, three-wheeler is a commercial vehicle, as we know, and almost 85 to 90% of these vehicles are sold through financing in India. So that's a very big sort of enabler of this whole industry. Now, coming to the context of electric vehicle, what has happened is that the unfortunately, the initial transition to electric in India started in this format through the low-end Chinese imports, etc., which have, poor life and the quality issues, etc., etc. So the perception in the mind of financiers is that it's a low-end vehicle, it's a low-quality vehicle, and obviously he is not sure about the life of the vehicle and the utility. That is as far as the vehicle aspect is concerned. Second is, in his mind, there is a question about the business robustness itself. The three-wheeler today, it is running in the e-commerce, last mile. But tomorrow, will he have that business or not? So it has to be, what is the soundness of this contract? Is it backed by some guarantee or some big player, etc.? So on the both vehicle side, there are questions. On the business side, there are questions. Now, see, to address the vehicle side, as I repeatedly said, technology has to play a role, and the robustness of the technology, the battery life, the battery performance, the motor efficiency, all these things play a huge role in making the vehicle efficient. Because more the uptime for my vehicle, more is the revenue, because most of the e-commerce companies pay like that, the number of packets you deliver, you get paid more. So it's quite a simple linear relationship. So if I am able to guarantee, let's say about 80 to 20 hours of uptime for my customer, then you have a viable business model, and it shows in our calculations also. The problem is that the vehicles that many of these guys have been using is that they are low-end vehicles, and the downtime is very high, and also the life of the vehicle is 6 months or 8 months because of the Indian road conditions, etc. So obviously the financier is right in his own way. He says that the vehicle life is 1 year, why should I finance? There is no second life or third life. So that is what is addressed by using the technology. Coming to the the viability of business, now all the big players like Amazon or Flipkart or Big Basket, etc., who are the major players in this industry, most of them have announced their policy to shift to the EV over next 3 to 5 years. Amazon, and these are global companies, if they come out with a mandate, it applies to everybody in India as well. So that is where I think the robustness of the business model comes, and we have our calculations which are backed by data. That if, for example, a user runs about 100 kilometers, then the business is viable. He's able to pay back the EMI. He's also able to take home certain amount of money, which takes care of his basic living standards. So this is where the role of technology, artificial intelligence, data analytics comes. And we can predict that if he's not running, for example, if the guy is not running 100 kilometers, then he is likely to be an NPA, and we can take care of it, and we can go and find out the reason. If there is a reason on the vehicle side, quality issue, battery issue, or if there is a problem with the business itself. So instead of waiting for the NPA to happen, we can predict with a very high level of accuracy that this is going to be a problem. So I think this is where certain innovation has to come from the financing companies as well. And this is a huge business, about $1 billion even today for financing of three-wheelers alone. And I think the financing companies, banks, are missing the bus here. They're not coming up with lending, and if, even if some of them are coming up, they're coming up with 22% and higher, which is not a viable proposition. So this is where I think one, the technology has to play a role, innovation has to play a role, and government has to make it like a prime lending sector, And anyway, 76% of the banks are public sector banks. Government has to play a role here to facilitate the financing. So I think in a nutshell, it is going to be the role of technology to ensure the robustness of vehicle. Commercial aspect has to be ensured by the customer side, user side, and overall the artificial or the IT has to play a role to make sure that the NPAs or the failures don't happen. So you can have geofencing, you can disable the vehicle, or you can find out what is the problem here. So I think this is where the solution lies.
Absolutely, sir. Now, Nilay, coming to you, with all the high-tech telematics that you have in your product, has that helped you getting finance companies on board? And what has been your experience with your customers with financing and resale, of course?
Yeah, so quick ones. I think financing being very critical for scale of this industry to pick up is completely undebatable. And I echo the sentiments that everybody is. And I think no matter what price point you're in, I think it's equally an important parameter, right? For the scale that this industry wants to get. Like buyback I was talking about, we put out a buyback to say in 3 years, we will buy back the vehicles at an X price. to take that pressure off. We could do that at a particular scale, but can that be the way OEMs are expected to run this? No. Right? Does technology, telematics help you in getting lower insurance rates? The answer is at a very early stage, no. Right? Because let's look at it from the bank's perspective. Right? Why do they need to move today? Right? What will happen if they move today versus they move, let's say, a year later, a couple of years later? There isn't that money value which is making this the top discussion in their boardrooms. Right? And like all of us mentioned, right, these are nationalized banks. They have been working in a particular format. They have tons and tons of data to build reliability. Schemes are not made in like a particular city. They are deployed centrally and then rolled out. Right? Which means that at the heart of this industry, there needs to be a very, very strong and fast movement which necessitates a percentage of loans to happen on the EVs. Here is one side where I think that if we keep waiting for natural demand, then we'll continue to have the chicken and egg problem, right? Because like by the time the natural demand depends a lot on, you know, customer having this facility. I'm right now not even talking about an advantage facility. I'm talking about an equal facility. While as an industry, I would suggest that here is one place where the government can start giving an advantage to a consumer over buying a petrol, because it's demand that's getting generated by directly giving something to the end consumer, right? Post-COVID, there will be a need to give more to the end consumer. And these are very strong ways of directing policy in a direction that shapes the industry, right? So if you look at from the OEM, from the loan providing bank's perspective, and going back to that quality discussion, unfortunately, when they think electric vehicles, the perception is the Chinese imports which stop working after a year. And that's probably like the death of that industry. Like I'm saying, which is why that loan industry doesn't pick up, because they don't have past data to support it. They don't have volume of data, because that volume of data has sort of not given like predictive models for them to think. There are no templates that exist that, you know, how, for example, even if we gave the telematics data, how to deploy it, what the second life value. So it's not something that they can take from another industry and quickly deploy it. So all of those are not available. And at the same time, there is no urgency that's coming either from a policy perspective or a demand in the next 1 or 2 year sort of perspective, right? This is like, and the other part, which is the unorganized lending, they don't have the awareness of electric vehicles. They would rather lend into like the smaller banks, the regional banks. They still do not have enough awareness of electric vehicles to start, you know, giving them. What it's resulting in is higher and higher credit rating requirement to give loans, right? No bank is saying that, hey, we will absolutely not giving it. For the last 5 years, I think they have been saying that, yes, we want to give it. But what is happening is that the credit rating difference is going up, which means that a huge chunk of consumers, while all of the work is happening, awareness is happening, government subsidy is happening, in the last mile, they're stopping because now there's a disparity between petrol and electric because of what loans that they can get and what credit rating they get. I think that's a very urgent thing for the government to solve, and not solve by like just making it equal. I think a very strong message needs to go on that aspect, because if you're looking at what levers can the government pull to make, let's say, the category 5% or 10% in the next 2 years, I would say this is one very top lever which is possible for the government to put up, which is a certain amount of assurance to that industry to say, hey, go on this path based on a set of products that we are talking about, whether through FAME, etc. And then we are there to back you up. I think that kind of assurance, and with a strong push to say this much percentage needs to happen, and then there is a particular incentive linked to it, is something that I think government policy can really help this industry.
Absolutely. We are almost out of time, but I need to put one question out. I wanted to talk about policy, but all of you have addressed policy in some way or the other. One quick question for all of you. We'll start with you, Gil Saab. Where do you see electric two-wheeler and three-wheeler market in the next 5 years? Say 2024, the next elections. Where do you see the electric two-wheeler and three-wheeler market?
See, like the magic of money doubling up and then creating billions, I think this industry is going more than double, irrespective of policy handicaps or the stimulus can make it much more. But as of today, certainly the industry doubles up from now. It is a small number, but in 5 to 10 years, it will be colossal, even at doubling.
Absolutely, sir. Jitender ji, what is your view on this? Next 5 years, where do you see Okinawa and two-wheeler and three-wheeler segment?
I think I'm a bit optimistic. I think after down the line 5 years, I think because of the push from every side, from all the stakeholders, from the government side, awareness is coming in a big way, new technologies innovating every day. So I think this market is going to be at least 15 to 20% of the total two-wheeler industry.
All right, sir. Dr. Mukherjee, three-wheelers, where do you see three-wheeler segment, in electric three-wheeler segment, in the next 5 years?
So we are very optimistic. I'm personally very bullish. And also, you know, there is a government mandate to be three-wheelers will have to be converted by 2023. So if that kicks in, then the question is solved. But, you know, in India, there are various other issues related to policy implementation, infrastructure, etc. But personally, if you ask my view, I feel that we have a number of 50% minimum conversion in case of three-wheelers. And just one quick word I would like to add here is that it is not only the whether two-wheelers, how many will convert, or three-wheelers, how many will convert. I think we'll have to see the complete ecosystem economic opportunity that we have. It has the economic benefit, it has the technology benefit, it also has the human resource development of a huge, you know, number of people to lift them into high-skilled jobs, etc., etc. So I think we should also take a holistic view of this, not only for the Indian domestic industry, but also for export of components, etc., and take a complete sort of holistic view while speculating such numbers. I mean, that's my view.
Great, sir. Nilay, now coming to you, where do you see electric two-wheelers in the next 5 years, along with Ather Energy, of course?
I think we'll continue to be bullish, and since the index is just going up, I'll continue that way. So I think this discussion more or less tells everybody's point of view is the government has to be and will be bullish on the policy side. And if that's the assumption, then I would agree with Mr. Dev on the three-wheelers going to a 50 to 55% in, let's say, 5 years from now, like 2026. I would say the motorcycle industry will take a little bit more time. So I would give it a 15 to 20% and scooters, I would imagine a 30 to 35%. Little optimistic, but that's what the industry should be.
No, it's really great to hear all of you being very optimistic about the future. Even as a journalist, I am very optimistic about electric vehicles. The moment I drove my first electric vehicle, I was sold. Although I don't need to buy cars or scooters as a journalist, but still, I was sold the moment I first pressed on the accelerator. So I believe awareness is a key issue. People need to get aware, try test driving electric scooters and four-wheelers and of course three-wheelers in commercial segment. And with that, we were ending this session. Thank you, Mr. Gill. Thank you, Mr. Jitendra. Thank you, Dr. Mukherjee. And thank you, Nilay, for joining us.